which is being, and also there is a pressure term also, and the collision, because of it, exchange of pressure, exchange of momentum, collisions are also perfectly elastic. But you see, it means, though we say that volume occupied by an ideal gas, whatever it should be, in the case of real gases, you observe, right? So at 50 degrees Celsius for carbon dioxide, it was observed that it behaves like an ideal gas, right? Yes, this theory completely explains you the behavior of ideal gases. I told you that there is a benchmark. You have to relate it to the ideal case. Ideal gases, though I say that it is a hypothetical concept, no gas in actual practice will behave like this, right? It is why that we have to modify this thing. Though this theory was given, but when the experiments were performed, we got different results. And these are some of the results which have been given, right? What happens that you define that all the gases which follow the ideal gas equation at all temperatures and all pressures, they are called what? Ideal gases, right? The gases which satisfy this condition at all temperature and pressure are called ideal gases. And ideal gases are those gases which fulfills the conditions or the postulates which are given by the kinetic molecular theory of gases. It means that gases would behave under all conditions of temperature and pressure by the way which has been described in the kinetic molecular theory of gases, which says that indirectly we have no intermolecular forces of attraction between the gaseous molecules, and the pressure which is being, and also there is a pressure term also, and the collision, because of it, exchange of pressure, exchange of momentum, collisions are also perfectly elastic. But you see, we have this term, which is PV, right, upon PV. We define this quantity at this step Z, which is called compressibility factor, right, PV upon PV ideal. For an ideal gas, this quantity has to remain constant. As per which law of the gases? PV has to remain constant. According to which law? Boyle's law. So that means ideal gases should follow Boyle's law under all the conditions of temperature. Now, PV should remain constant. Therefore, this is what this PV is, PV of real gases. When we compare the results, we were given a theory according to this. This is the case. And this is the result of your experiment. When we perform experiment on different gases, so what happens that different gases were taken and their behavior was studied. So then we found that this particular quantity, though we say that it should remain constant, but it is not so. It does not remain constant. So rather, this is sometimes greater than this, sometimes it is lesser than this. Sometimes it is equal to the ideal gas also, but in very, very few cases. So we define here a new quantity, which is called compressibility factor. Why do we call it compressibility factor? During this thing, I will explain you that. Let us see the curves. You can put here, you can define this, which is equal to PV upon NRT also. Right? PV upon NRT, or you can say PV real upon PV ideal. Both are the definitions of your compressibility factor. Now, if the gases, they satisfy the conditions of an ideal gas, they behave, or I mean to say that if they behave ideally, then what should be the value of Z? One, because if these two are equal, then we should get the ratio equal to 1. This is equal to 1. So it means when we plot Z versus P, it is to study the behavior of different gases, hydrogen, helium, oxygen, nitrogen, methane, and carbon dioxide. All these different gases were taken. And when these plots were observed, what do we observe here? That as per your ideal gas equation, and if you say that your gases, they do behave ideally, you should only get this straight line where the Z is equal to 1. Here, Z is equal to 1. You should always get a straight line which is parallel to the x-axis. But you are not getting so. Right? This thing never happens. Why? Because your real gases, they do not behave ideally. That means they deviate from ideal behavior. I'm switching over from ideal to real gases. Right? All the laws, kinetic theory of gases, were able to describe, or they were able to predict the behavior of an ideal gases. But when we compared the results of real gases with those of the theory and laws which are given for ideal gases, the two differ, right? When the two are differing from each other, we see that what could be the reason and under what condition. There's two questions which comes to our mind. Under what conditions the gases deviate from ideal behavior, right? And why do they deviate from ideal behavior? Two things should be clear in our mind, right? So one, you see that at extremely low pressure, this is the pressure axis, extremely low pressure, the value of Z is almost 1. Almost 1, though it is for very, very short region. Aapko shayad dikhai bhi nahi de raha hoga, theek se. But it is there. For a very, very small range of pressure, the value of Z is 1. But at a high pressure, you see, at high pressure, all the gases, they have Z greater than 1. Right? Greater than 1. Z is greater than 1. What do we mean by this? I will explain you now why do we call it compressibility factor. It means when Z is greater than 1, PV real gases is greater than PV of ideal gases. It means, though we say that volume occupied by an ideal gas, whatever it should be, in the case of real gases, you observe it is not equal to the ideal gas. The volume of an ideal gas is not equal to the volume of the real gas. This is a different quantity. It means now, right, that you cannot compress the gases to a certain extent. What do we mean by at high pressure? What actually should happen, that at high pressure, when pressure is high, volume should be small. When volume is small, see, Z is greater than 1 means gases are less compressible. That is why we call it compressibility factor. If Z is greater than 1, the gases are less compressible. If Z is less than 1, gases are highly compressible. Highly compressible gases are actually your ideal gases, right? They always behave like gases. But you see that at high pressure, all these gases, they have Z equal to 1, greater than 1. Greater than 1 means we cannot compress them easily. They are difficult to compress. You understand the meaning of Z. Z is greater than 1 means they are difficult to compress. Why they are difficult to compress? You relate it to the pressure. Pressure is high. Very high pressure. Volume is very, very less. Volume is very, very less. So molecules are what? Very close to each other. If they are very close to each other, right, then what happens? your intermolecular forces of repulsion, you know that attractive forces are dominating at higher distance, and at shorter distance, repulsive forces, they come into roles, right? You try to compress them, just like the case, if you have two atoms, right? You are bringing them together, together, together. They will come close to each other at a certain particular distance, but after that, they would start repelling each other. There will be a collision. They will repel each other. So, at high pressure, they come so close to each other that they start repelling each other. When they start repelling each other, it is difficult to compress them. I hope it is clear to you. It is so they are less compressible. When we compare it with the value of Z at, I explained you the two extreme cases. When pressure is very, very low, they behave ideally. Z is equal to 1. When pressure is very, very high, explain you the other reason, gases are less compressible. They deviate to a greater extent. But what happens at moderate pressure? At moderate pressure, the gases, they show this kind of behavior. Means the Z first decreases, 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 right? And then it will acquire a minimum value and then again start increasing. When Z is negative, here you see, Z is what? Less than 1. When Z is less than 1, it means gases are highly compressible. Why? Because in that case, what? Your volume of the real gas is lesser than the volume of your ideal gas, right? So what happens that at that stage, when pressure is moderate, the attractive forces are dominating. Attractive forces are dominating, they can easily be compressed, right? So gases are highly compressible in this region, right? Z is less than 1. Less than 1, highly compressible, greater than 1, less compressible, equal to 1, ideal gases, right? Now, as per all the laws and theories, we should ideally get what? That we can compress the gas to any extent. But real gases, they do not behave so, right? So it means, however, you see, you did not ask me that for hydrogen and helium, it was not the case. It is always greater than 1. It is because, what happens? That it is because of this reason that these gases are known as permanent gases also. This is the region where they can, when they are highly compressible, they turn into what? If you compress, compress and compress, they will turn into a liquid, right? So these are all gases which are easily liquefiable gases. You can liquefy them by increasing pressure. You increase the pressure, they can be liquefied. But hydrogen and helium, you've hardly heard about liquid. I mean, it is very, very difficult to get liquefied hydrogen, right? And helium. That is why they are called permanent gases. It is because you have to bring down the temperature, because you are only talking about the pressure here. We have not talked about, if we see the variation of temperature also, the temperature at which the Z will become negative for hydrogen and helium is very, very less. Minus 165 degrees Celsius. These curves have been plotted at 0 degrees Celsius. These curves, they have been plotted at 0 degrees Celsius, right? At 0 degrees Celsius, it is impossible to liquefy hydrogen and helium, because the temperature at which they can be compressed and turned to a liquid, it is very, very low. Minus 165 degrees Celsius for hydrogen, minus 240 degrees Celsius for helium. So if you can bring down the temperature to that level, they will also behave like other gases. Next. Right. So, what you can conclude in nutshell, that ideal gases, real gases, right? The real gases, they do behave, they do deviate from ideal behavior, right? So, two questions, again I say, that why do they deviate and under what conditions they deviate. That is more important, because experiment did not I mean, we could not get the same results by which were predicted by theory, right? So we have to find, there must be some flaw in the kinetic theory of gases. When we say that theory predicts this, an experiment says something else, then we must have to analyze that what went wrong with the theory, which led to the different results of theory and experiment. So it was found that these were the two postulates. There were two postulates of the kinetic molecular theory, which were actually not completely right. I would not say that they are wrong, but they are not being fulfilled at all conditions of temperature and pressure. First thing that the very first postulate of kinetic molecular theory, we assume that gaseous molecules, they are tiny particles, right? They have no volume in comparison to the total volume of the gas, but it is not so. That statement is true at high temperature and low pressure. If your volume is very, very large, the total volume of the gas is very, very large, then you can ignore the volume of the individual molecule. But if you compress it, you increase the pressure, volume becomes smaller. If volume is smaller, total volume is less, then you cannot ignore the volume of the individual molecule in comparison to the total volume, right? So one flaw, that means we need to make correction to the volume term, right? Next is that there are no intermolecular forces. We assume that gaseous molecules, they do not have intermolecular forces, attractive forces, which are binding the molecules together. If there are not intermolecular forces of attraction, then you should actually, not get the condition of the liquefaction. But you observe in real practice that you increase the pressure. When you increase the pressure, gases, their volume decreases, and ultimately you are able to convert gases into liquid. If they are converting into a liquid, and you know that in liquid, intermolecular forces of attraction are dominating, right? So it means this statement which says that there are no intermolecular forces of attraction is also not right, not completely right under all conditions of temperature and pressure. So one thing that these two postulates, they had some flaw. The second thing, that under what condition? So meanwhile discussing this, I also discussed that if you have high pressure and low temperature, the gases, they do deviate from ideal behavior, because at high pressure, the gas molecules, they are close to each other. Then both the conditions, they will have intermolecular forces of attraction also, which is in contrary to the kinetic theory. And also they would have some significant volume in comparison to the total volume of the gas, right? Two questions are asked, answered now. Under what condition? Under the condition of high pressure and low temperature, the gases behave different from ideal behavior. They show real behavior. And the gases which deviate from ideal behavior are known as, either we can call it non-ideal, but we have given a name, real gases, right? Because in real practice, in real world gases, they do not behave like an ideal gas. So ideal gas was a hypothetical concept. We explained and we come to the conclusion that real gases, they do behave differently. If they do behave differently, then next thing which should come to our mind, that okay, up till now we were using this equation very comfortably. But since this is only for the ideal gases, then how can we use the same equation for the real gases? We should have a different equation for the real gases also, because the real gases, they do not behave ideally. So the equation, which is ideal gas equation, should also be invalid for real gases. So we put a restriction here that this ideal gases, the all the gases, in fact, I must say, all the gases at high temperature and low pressure behave ideally. If they behave ideally under these conditions, then this equation is valid. So under these conditions, this equation is valid. Under the opposite conditions, under high pressure and low temperature, we need to have some different equation, which is your van der Waal equation. Van der Waal, next slide. Van der Waal studied this, and these two corrections were made to the ideal gas equation. We need to correct the volume term, right? So I already explained you that volume of an ideal gas, right? Volume of an ideal gas is slightly what? It is overestimated. I hope you understand the meaning of overestimated. Means the volume of an ideal gas is slightly higher than the volume of a real gas. So that means we need to subtract some volume. So minus NB correction term. This is a volume correction. So the real volume is now V minus NB. And pressure, because you know that there was a correction to the pressure term also, because all we can only vary pressure and volume. These are the, now pressure correction, because pressure, you see that this molecule which is in the bulk is experiencing forces, balanced forces from all the different directions, right? But this, which is at the surface or at the boundary, is experiencing only inward forces, right? So this is being pulled by these molecules inside. So it means the pressure which we expect should be ideally what? What we observe is, in case of ideal gas, the pressure is lesser than the pressure in the real gas. It is because these molecules would not create, I mean, all the molecules are not actually responsible for exerting equal pressure. So pressure for all the molecules will not be equal. So it is actually lesser than. Now when it is lesser, we need to add, right? So this quantity An square upon V square. Next slide. So after making these two corrections, a new equation of state which came into role and which completely explained the behavior of real gases, this is called van der Waal equation. Van der Waal gas equation or equation of state. Equation of state in general, because it explains the state of any gas. Since it explains the state of a real gas, we call it equation of van der Waal gas. I mean, all the gases which satisfy this equation are called either real gases in general, or we call it van der Waal gases also, right? A and B, they are called van der Waal constants, right? Next. Now the last topic which we have in gases, very quickly I will, because I will have to cover the liquids also. Liquefaction process, right? Liquefaction process, as I told you, that look at this curve. Andrews was the first person who studied the liquefaction. Although we say that real ideal gases, they would always remain gases. Ideal gases, what is the concept of ideal gases? That they would always remain ideal gases, gases. But it is not so. They turn to liquid, then to solid, if you decrease the temperature, right? And increase the pressure, right? The same thing here. We performed the experiment, this Andrews, he performed the experiment, pressure versus volume curves. This is the curve which you get in case of Boyle's law. You increase the pressure, right? Volume decreases. Volume decrease or an x-axis way, right? So you get a curve like this. But this is, say, at this curve, which is almost like a behavior of an ideal gas, it is at 50 degrees Celsius, right? So at 50 degrees Celsius for carbon dioxide, it was observed that it behaves like an ideal gas, right? That the moment you keep on increasing the pressure, volume decreases, and so on, right? But you decrease the temperature, right? You decrease the temperature, you will get this curve, which is represented by green line, right? So again, what happens? That you see that there is also a variation between the pressure and volume, but at if you can switch off the light for some, this is not visible then. Okay, anyways, what happens that at this point you further keep on reducing, and at 30.56 degrees Celsius, at 31 degrees Celsius, you will observe that at this point, what happens? The gas starts liquefying, right? It starts liquefying, and it just appears. The liquid state just appears. And then after that, what happens? That it is now, after this point, it is what? Liquid. And then if you compress the liquid, because they are less compressible, so you increase the pressure, volume, there will be very small change in the volume, very small, because you cannot compress the liquids to a greater extent. Then you further keep on reducing the temperature, right? These all are called isotherms, because at different temperatures, you keep temperature for one curve constant, right? You observe that at slightly 21.5 degrees Celsius. See, volume decreases. At this point, liquefaction starts. But all the molecules, entire gas, cannot be turned to a liquid at a particular moment, right? What happens? That it will start condensing. And this is the region where liquid and gas, they are in equilibrium. You have both the phases. And this is the point where you have complete liquid. And further, if you increase the pressure, there will be hardly any change in the volume. If you keep on reducing the temperature, you will get that this flat portion, it is increasing. And if you keep on increasing this temperature, the flat portion reduces to point here. Right? It means that, what do you conclude from here? That temperature above 31 degrees Celsius, you cannot liquefy carbon dioxide. You will always have a gas. Whatever pressure you apply, you can never get liquid carbon dioxide. Is it understood? That it is only below a certain temperature that you can liquefy a gas. It is from where the concept of critical temperature came. Right? So this temperature below which a gas can be liquefied and above which it can never be liquefied is called critical temperature. So for carbon dioxide, it is 31 degrees Celsius, right? Below 31, any temperature you can liquefy carbon dioxide, but above 31, you cannot. Above 31, you take 33 degrees Celsius, and you may be thinking that I can compress it to any extent, I can apply high pressure, and it will turn to a liquid. No, you will never be able to. Because both the conditions, temperature and pressure, they are necessary to liquefy. Right? That is why we say that at this ideal, but at opposite, high pressure and low temperature, you can only liquefy the gas. Right? So both the conditions are necessary. Next. So critical constants, they were defined. Right? So critical constant, critical temperature is the minimum temperature which is required to liquefy the gas. Right? And then critical volume is the volume occupied by the gas at critical temperature. And then critical pressure is the pressure which is required, say for carbon dioxide at 31 degrees Celsius. How much pressure is required to liquefy? 73 atmosphere. If you look back to the same curves, it was 73 atmosphere. So that means at 31 degrees Celsius, you need 73 atmospheric pressure in order to liquefy or compress carbon dioxide. If you further have lower temperature, less pressure would be required because the two are obviously related, right? So it is from where I will ask you a question. You can note it down, and probably if we have time, we can discuss in the end. What is the difference between a gas and a vapor? Think upon it. What is the difference between a gas and vapors? Next. Right? Differentiate between a gas and vapor. And you have this question also. Skip this.